How do you feel? You ready for go over the top on psychedelia? All right, there's no treats being passed around tonight. Just so you know, but you know, someday. This session is sponsored by Sound Toys, and I can think of no better plugins to attack the psychedelic angle. So thank you very much to Sound Toys for helping make it happen. There's a couple things I want to say about Stu. First off is that he works with the highest level people. If Beyoncé goes to Tahiti and then gets a place 100 miles from the nearest island and there's one person with her to record the vocal, it's going to be Stuart White. That's pretty incredible. I know you have a very cool song and a great mix to break down for us, so let's dig in. Let's talk about a mix.
Yeah.
Thank you all for coming out. Really, really appreciate it. Like, this is super cool. It's an honor to be here. And I got this track. It's called Shipping Yard. It's this Australian artist who's super dope. He has a couple different music projects, and this is one of them. His website's called Mossy Loves You. It's at the top of the session, so if you want to go check it out, that's how you check it out. I'm just going to play it for you, and then we'll get into like what I did to it. This was a track that I didn't record, I mixed it, but I went really heavy-handed with everything. They kind of gave it to me with just general reverb on the vocals and things, and the drums. Dean Tuzo, the producer, he killed the production, and he did a lot of stuff to the drums, and I just kind of took it another step forward as far as the processing goes. And I used so many plugins on this mix. It's in Pro Tools 10, so it's not as quick as 11, but I used so many plugins on it that I literally had to bounce everything down as I was mixing it or it wouldn't play back. So I can't show you so much on the drums exactly the settings, but on the vocals I got everything that we can go through in detail. But I'm gonna break down the drums, I guess, first. The main loop here that he chopped up from some live drums and processed them, I think, in Ableton. Oh yeah, and the other thing I was gonna mention too is I used a summing box when I mixed this, and I don't have the summing box here. I also used a massive passive EQ and a SSL clone. And a compressor, and I don't have that here, so I simulated the best I could. So if I play the whole song, I'll try to remember to play the actual mix print, because it's slightly different. Anyway, here's the loop. I never did that before, but I'll... From there, there's definitely EQ and distortion and things I'm tweaking on that, but then I was like, yo, what would, like, to get some real sub out of it, which I'm all about the sub. So I took it down an octave and like mangled it. Like that's the thing, but obviously I can't have the whole song like that. Together like that, because the tempo and the groove of it, you can have those sub frequencies because it's not like super fast, so you can make that sub work like, you know, like a hip-hop record, which is definitely the direction we wanted to go. We want to be like psychedelic rock with like sub hip-hop drums. There's this other drum part that comes in right here. that guy. It wasn't anywhere near that distorted, but I was like, I totally want to distort that. So, and then since the octave thing worked so good on the other one, I was like, let me try it again. But I had to do it differently, and you'll see. So that sounds like sans imp to me. I'm pretty sure I usually sans imp on that. And filtered that a lot of the sub off of that one because it didn't work in that spot for whatever reason. So I
sans
imp to change the octave? No, sans imp is for the distortion and probably an elastic for the pitch. And tons of plugins. I mean, sometimes I fill up every insert on the sound. I do that a lot. And then I'll do that so much, I send it to an aux, and then I put another 6 plugins on it. Like, literally, because it's, I mean, there's no rules, right? And, but a lot of times everything's doing a tiny little thing. And then you're like, oh, I'm using like 9 plugins. Oh, I should go back and try to do this with 3. I'm like, nah, fuck that. It sounds good. I'm just going to keep adding until I get it. Because at the end of the day, I'm mangling these sounds. So, who cares? And then I'll just render it. And a lot of times it's like, you distort something. So, and you don't want it to be spiky and to be hurting your ears all the time. And you play it loud. So you got to compress it beforehand to control it before it hits the distortion, so it distorts evenly and saturates evenly, and then you gotta EQ it and like notch out frequencies that are problematic, and then you gotta multiband it and all that kind of crap. So then it just gets, pretty crazy. There's this 808 in here. I didn't really use much of it because I felt like the sub that I was doing from the break was really doing the business of the sub. And so, it's just slightly in there. Just you really focused on it, you can hear it, but I really didn't want too much of that, so that was a subtle thing. What is this guy? I forgot what this guy is. Oh yeah. That's the shit that makes me happy right there. It's like, when I hear stuff like that, I'm just like, yeah. But you gotta use it correctly. It's a fine line with this stuff from being corny as fuck or like really cool, so you gotta be careful. I'm gonna play the whole mix real quick so you can hear that little spot. So that impact, like that emotion that I'm trying to bring out, create an accent point or something. I did an octave on it, I very speeded it. I think I processed it a bunch and then I put these plugins on after I processed it. So everybody knows this guy, awesome UAD fan. And then phaser, love this phaser, really good one. And then I got slow compression just to control all that reverb. I'm a big fan with stuff like with songs like this, compressing the reverbs, like doing all the tonal and timbre stuff, and then putting compressors behind it to control it. Because when you have that much effects on something, if you don't, it's just gonna it's gonna be coming out at you too much, and you want to just park it right there and make it stay. So there's a kick that I use a lot. It's just a kick that I got a long time ago. And I use it all the time, and I manipulate it different in every situation, but it's basically a kick that kind of doesn't have any color. It just has fundamental punch and frequencies. So a lot of times I'll get something and the drums will have tons of vibe and it'll be like hip-hopped out and just like super, super nasty and good, but they don't have that fundamental punch and transient. So I will line this kick up to it and then manipulate it into the track. And by itself, it kind of sounds kind of stupid, but in the mix, it's kind of cool. And then I took another one of the same kick across that different end. You got that top end. Very cool. I'm literally just looping the section of the drums, trying stuff, just trying this, trying that, filtering that, boosting that, trying to find the frequencies. I'm a big fan of just using the stock digi EQ, grabbing the dot, doing a tight cue, and like finding where it's happy, and then conjunction with other stuff, and then playing with the phase, and that IBP tool is really good for that. just to kind of find like, okay, now it's snapped together. And once it snaps together, then it's like, you know, you got it. Okay, now we got some toms. These again, kind of like the 808, I mixed them really low because I didn't feel like they needed to be in your face. Let me play. It's a really cool sound. And I think at first I was trying to make it like more present in the mix, but I ended up just sacrificing it and kind of having it as an accent thing and play it on the track. It's such a subtle thing, but those subtle things are like, it just gives everything such personality. There's this clap, straight up clap that we've all heard a million times. I can't remember if I just did the distorted duplicates or if Dean did, but either way, we got these distorted duplicates. That one's got some verb on it. And that one's got more meat, more chest on it. It fills it out. So you can see how the summing really helped glue the track. I just played it without the summing on there. And it's like amazing what that Chandler did to this mix. I really love it. I don't use it every time. I don't think I need to every time, but on this song it worked like a charm. Okay, we got the upbeat. Yeah, this is kind of like the accent. Still, there's a lot of sub in there, so I have like a lot of these things that have sub going on. So yeah, it's just a little accent. Let's play the mix again. So it's like real subtle in there, but it's there. Because, you know, at that point in the song, it's all about that guitar line. And you're introducing the song, so I didn't want too much stuff, you know, distracting you and just like kind of introducing you into the groove. And okay, yeah, so this came to me with some verb on it already, and then I put a ton more stuff on it and probably compressed it up a bit. So yeah, just more little things to go up under to kind of make it feel cool. So it's in there, you know, it's just like subtle. I don't try to overthink shit. I just like, that feels good, and I just keep going.
How much do you automate?
A lot. Yeah, I don't necessarily just do tons of rides just down the song all the time, but I automate plugins a lot on and off, or I automate frequency sweeps, and I automate reverb controls. There are rides going through, but it's more just kind of, I try to get it all working together as best I can without a ton of rides. And then I'll go in and like, okay, this needs a ride, that needs a ride. Let's see, so now we're up to the bass. All right, so we got some plugins I can bypass so you can hear where we started. All right, so let's play the bass. Okay, so that's the bass, but if you notice, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 plugins on the track itself, and then it goes to a bass aux where I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 more plugins. I'm not afraid to do that. You know, like I do it all the time because to me it sounds good, and everything is there for a reason. I'm not just, you know, oh, let me just throw a bunch of shit on there, you know, and like tell us. It's like, if you think about it, like if you record a bass and say, you know, okay, you're recording it, you got 3 mics on a bass cab, and then you're running, you know, through this, you know, Neve, and you're EQing it, you're compressing it, and okay, level pull tech, da 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 da. Oh, there's a little problem frequency, GML, okay, and then you got this other mic, oh, let's run that through a stands amp pedal, and okay, now I need to compress that hard, and da da da. So, and then you track it, and boom, it's in the computer, and like, okay, you already did a lot of that, and then the mixer comes in and adds more stuff to fit it into the mix. You count all those things, it's kind of the same thing. So, it's, again, I'm not afraid of just putting tons on there and just being proud of it. Okay, so I think we had 2 more plugins on this bass. Let's get 2 real quick. So like, yeah, smack, just to compress all those, the boosting, you know, because I'm boosting frequencies, so I need to compress it, tighten it up a little again. This is something I don't know what normally do, is L2, the bass, but in this one, in this song, it worked, because I just needed it to kind of sit in this spot, and I liked it, so I did it. But. So that's like the final bass line. So it's got the mids and the lows and everything, but it's kind of even and sits nice. Let me go back to the track real quick so you can hear that. So yeah, and there's, you know, there's a lot of bass stuff going on, so getting all that stuff to work. It's always tricky. What else? Hammond organ. Just doing a little EQ, a little compression. I probably processed that and printed it at some point, but that's pretty straightforward. That's hard to tell. That's a cool sound right there. I like that sound. Again, big shout to Dean Tuza who produced this, man. He's a maniac. He's so good. Just straight up. All right, I'm gonna get into the vocals before we get too crazy. These guitars, again, like, I processed them quite a bit and printed them, but. Slap. Yeah, that's pretty much it. I really want to get into these vocals though. So there's two, there's a double, he did a real double, not like a fake double. I hate fake doubles. And let's just go through that. There's a ship in the yard. About 100 yards from here. So initially I mixed this song, like music, everything, and the vocal was much drier. And I think it might've been a different take. And then I mixed another song and they wanted like a lot of effects on the vocals. They were like, we really want that swimming in effects thing. So I did it and it came out cool. And then the Mossy came back and he's like, I love what you did on the other song. I really want you to do that to my vocal on this song as well. So all right, cool. So we recalled it. And then that's when I just went crazy with all this stuff. And let me see if I can just break them down real quick. There's a ship in the yard. Okay, dry. About 100 yards from here. That's Primal Tap. It's a kind of an emulation of an old, I think, Lexicon delay back in the day. And the cool thing about it is it would change the sample rate. To give you more delay time, so it got grainier and dirtier as you go. And like, you know, you get more repeats, which is what you have to do a lot of times with delays anyway. You have to filter the top end to sit them back in the mix. And then I got the widener, which when I pulled this up without the summing, there was something going on with the EQ and the compression, and the flanger didn't sound quite as like this, but whatever. It's good enough for demonstration purposes. There's a ship in the yard, about 100 yards from here. So like psychedelic, you need the flanger. And then we got what I call the dope delay. Probably because I was really excited when I made it. I was like, I'm gonna call it the dope delay. let's see here. And then the dope delay is going to the AKG spring in Altaverb, the BX22. If anybody out here has one of those, man, you know the thing is the jam. It's like, and Altaverb one's pretty really good, and the UAD has a really good one too. So the dope delay. There's a ship in the yard. About
Okay.
And then you put the reverb on.
There's a shipping yard about 100 yards.
So in solo, that sounds crazy. You know, it's like, wow, there's so much shit going on. But in the track, you know, it kind of works. So, again, I'll just play it all with the effects, and I'll play the track again.
There's a shipping yard about 100 yards from here, where I would keep my wheels.
Let's play the mix. You can see how there's like a lot of stuff going on, but you can hear it. You can understand everything he's saying. He's right there in the forefront, and the delays are creating the vibe and the textures that we want, but it's controlled.
There's a shipping yard about 100 yards from here.
Combo tap is the actual delay. Double lock is just coloring it. And then I'm compressing the crap out of it. Here it comes.
There's a shipping yard about 100 yards from here.
Because again, it's so exaggerated. If I don't crush it and just make it stay there, it'll just be obnoxiously in your face. I really like this filter. It's like a, this little resonant peak that it does. I got a really sidechain delay, which I do a lot with stuff like this. I'll basically just sidechain the delay to the vocal. And you could say, oh, you could just compress the delay. The delay is coming from the vocal, but it's still not the same shape. You know, the vocal itself has a shape. And now I want this compressor, now that I have this super distorted compressed delay, I want it basically to get out of the way when he sings, you know?
There's a shipping yard.
So it comes out.
About 100 yards from here, where I would...
The beauty of sidechaining. And then I'm just doing the automation rods to just cut it when I want to cut it. This guy's pretty straightforward. That MXR, just taking off load. And this one just compressing really hard too. Let's go right to it.
Yeah.
So that widener is getting crushed as well.
About 100 yards from here.
Just to make it stay there. And whatever dynamics I like have in like the way the compression is grabbing his vocal, all the effects stay behind that and never get in the way. Let me show you the vocal and just how we got that, the timbre quality of the vocal. So start off with the Q1, just notching out a problematic frequency of like 2500, looks like. And then did like a, we did this with a 421 microphone, which is a tricky mic to record with handheld, because like you touch it, it just, you hear it. So I think I actually had to go and do surgery and like remove a bunch of like rattles and stuff, but tonally it sounded really cool. Let me just take this distortion off and show you what it sounds like without it.
There's a shipping yard.
So that's cool, you know, like, you know, we put the distortion on, a little de-esser behind it to control the way the S's get exaggerated from the distortion.
There's a shipping yard.
Just got way cooler. Like, more energy, more vibe. And it's literally just like, I think the straight up, just stock saturation one, turn the amount up, and adjust the intensity a little bit, and it worked great. All the way wet. Little de-essing.
There's a shipping yard.
That's the other thing, like, when you distort vocals real heavily like that, you know, having being able to, you know, control the problematic frequencies that arise from doing that, where it'd be like spiky 3K peaks and stuff like that. Like, it'll sound great, and then they hit that one note, and it's like, yikes. It goes, like, in your ear, and it feels like a needle. And you can, like, notch that out or use multiband compression. I think I'm doing that, too. And just, like, massage and control those problematic frequencies. There's a shipyard. Oh, my guy right there. Actually, we skipped the 1176. There's a shipyard. So when this got recorded, it got compressed, and we compressed it again. But a slow attack and a slow release, typically with like a rap vocal or something like that, where I want to like super in your face, I'll do a fast release. And but in this sense, I want, again, you know, the texture of the track and the vibe of the track, I want to sit him in there a little bit more. So I did a slower release. And then, yes, another C4. There's a shipyard. Just controlling a little boost. And this guy, gotta give props where props is due. To Mr. Dave Pensado, this is his trick that he came up with the C1. I think he put it in an EQ magazine like years ago, and I took a cut it out of a magazine and like had it in my bag, you know, because it was so useful. Because it's basically a single band compression, and there's spiky peaks and stuff like that. In this case, it was around that same area as I notched out earlier, 2650. It was getting out of control, so like, you know, zap it with the C1. There's a shipyard. I take it off. There's a shipyard. Hear that? It's like, put it on. There's a shipyard. Gone. Everybody can like use this. That is so good. But yeah, that's definitely Dave Pensado right there, boy. And then again, same frequency, just a little bit over. I'm notching more of that out. There's a shipyard. There's a shipyard. It sounds better. Again, like I notched that frequency like 3 times now, but it just keeps getting better. So it was still not quite fixed. And then this guy, I really love this guy. This is a super dope tape emulator by Slate. It's very useful. And it just kind of gave some saturation to everything. There's a shipyard. There's a shipyard. So just smooths it out a little bit, tame some of those transients, and just kind of helps sit everything back. And then this is a really great plugin too. I'll use all the time. It has no color, and you can filter things out without getting weird phase things happening with low end and or anything. And I'm doing almost nothing but just boosting a little 7. Okay, so we got some backgrounds too. That's right. So it looks like I printed this, but it was probably the phaser that comes stock, the air plug-in phaser, I think. Dean might have done that, I'm not sure. And then we got the horns. Okay, so that's dry. And then I put some more BX22 on there, but a different one. I'm doing the pre-delay with an Echo Boy. So I'm not actually using the built-in pre-delay. I chose to use the Echo Boy for that. And then just doing a little EQ after that with that guy. Another thing that I was going to say is, like, as far as background vocals, I'm a big fan. Once you get the blend and get a good EQ on it and get it sounding pretty good, commit it. You know, like, don't be afraid to commit it and then just have it on one track. You can put the tracks, you know, in the session up out of the way. You know, but it really messes up my head when I'm looking at a session. There's like 9 trillion vocals, and then I gotta remember where everything is. And it's like in a tracking stage, yeah, you gotta do that. But once you, you know, you get to a point where like that blend, everybody likes that blend, the image and all that stuff, just commit it. You can go back to it because it really frees up your brain to be able to manage this many tracks of vocals rather than, you know, a whole screen full, and then which makes you faster and more clear and make better decisions and all that good stuff. But yeah, that's it. That's the mix. Yeah.